This episode discusses Step 3 and how it's been misconstrued. As a result, the word God is going to show up. We will get into more detail about Episode 1's topic of God being optional in a later episode. But for the moment, let's look at Step 3 and try to untangle it from rumor and misinformation first. For anyone, agnostic, atheist, or believer, the idea that they are to turn their will and lives over to the care of God as we understood them is often where they jump ship. To make matters worse, there's this endlessly repeated notion told to newcomers that the third step is just a decision. That's a ridiculous assertion that doesn't hold up to even the most cursory inspection. A little harsh? Maybe. And to make matters worse, when questioned about this just-a-decision thing, some 12-step members claim that the action of Step 3 is to do Step 4? Really? So in order to have lunch, we eat dinner? In order to build a house, we construct the roof before the foundation? Who completes one thing by doing a different thing? Why is this important? Decisions, by their very nature, are statements of intent. A decision to have lunch requires me to make lunch and eat it. A decision to become a doctor requires me to sign up for college and learn medicine. Decisions in and of themselves accomplish nothing. They point in a direction, but they require action to achieve. And when it comes to decisions, the one asked of us in Step 3 is a life-changing one, regardless of whether we believe in God, a chair, or an idea. To prepare ourselves for what that decision will require of us, there needs to be a realignment of our approach to life, an action that will start to change how we react to life. That's not my opinion. Bill Wilson says as much in Appendix 2 of the Big Book, where he describes the spiritual experience of the early members. He writes that the recovered alcoholic, quote, realizes he's undergone a profound alteration in his reaction to life. In a moment, we'll look at what Step 3 directs us to do. But first, let's see what the author says about the third step in other AA literature to see if there are any clues about an action being needed in addition to the decision. In a collection of essays about the steps in the book called 12 Steps and 12 Traditions, Bill Wilson writes, quote, like all the remaining steps, Step 3 calls for action. That's pretty clear. Step 3 includes an action according to the person who wrote the steps. So how did a step that its author says requires action become just a decision? Like all the steps of the AA program, they can be found in the Big Book. And Step 3 is laid out in Chapter 5. But most people's knowledge of Chapter 5 is limited to its first 2.5 pages. Decades ago, someone decided to use the opening of that chapter for a short reading at the start of AA meetings. The usually laminated snippet is even called How It Works, which is the title of Chapter 5. The problem is that the out-of-context snapshot includes only the, what I call, headline version of the steps, the bullet list in poster form that often can be found hung behind the chairperson's desk at a meeting. The poster doesn't include the directions about how to apply the step to one's life, and it also leaves out integral parts of some of the steps as well. There are actually three steps on the poster that are misrepresented. Step 3 misses the action and focuses on the decision. Step 5 includes the admission of our wrongs, but doesn't mention the review of steps 1 through 5 after the admission. Step 11 only mentions prayer and meditation in the morning, but leaves out the evening review, the part also commonly confused with Step 10. In any case, Step 3 begins on page 60 with the line, being convinced we are at Step 3. The author then says he'll explain what he means by turning our will and our life over, and also what to do to accomplish that. Now, in the interest of brevity, I'm going to paraphrase what Wilson wrote next. Listeners who want to read the original in full can turn to page 60 of the Big Book, where it says, being convinced, and read through to the end of page 62. Wilson starts by saying that to understand what turning one's will and life over means, we have to first be convinced that any life run on what he calls self-propulsion can't be successful. He says that such a life is almost always in collision with something or somebody. It's also in direct opposition to turning one's life and will over to God. The analogy Wilson uses to explain what he means by a life run on self-propulsion is that of an actor who shows up at a theater where there's a director and production crew waiting. Instead of playing his role, that of an actor, he plays the role of the director. He decides to run the show, where the show is a metaphor for life. Wilson uses two examples of how we try to run the show. The first is an effort to be gracious and charming, also known as manipulation. The other is being mean and demanding. There's also a third way, which is entirely internal, sitting there silently judging people and situations and getting upset that others aren't doing what we want them to, or that situations aren't different. Our efforts at self-propulsion usually fail and generate resentment and lead to conflict with others. It's also the opposite of trying to turn one's will and life over to God, and that's why there's an action. An action has to begin the transformation from self-propulsion to something else. Wilson ends his example of a life run on self-propulsion with the observation, so our troubles, we think, are basically of our own making. And that means we need to start doing something differently. He writes, this is the how and the why of it. First of all, and I need to stop right there for a sec to point out that making lists of things to do usually means writing them down in order, maybe numbering them, or at least jotting them down in sequence. Wilson starts the how part of step three with the word first. He's letting us know that this is the first thing we need to do, and by implication that there'll be at least one more thing to do as well. He says that to prepare ourselves for a life not run on self-propulsion, we first have to. Okay, here's the full quote. This is the how and the why of it. First of all, we had to quit playing God. Now, if that's the first part, what's the second? Here's the entire quote. This is the how and the why of it. First of all, we had to quit playing God. It didn't work. Next, we decided that hereafter in this drama of life, God was going to be our director. So now we have the action, quit playing God, and the decision, next we decided. This is the how and the why of it, the how and why to stop running life on self-propulsion, which is the opposite of turning one's will and life over. First of all, we had to quit playing God. That's the how, the action. It didn't work. That's the why. Next, we decided, and there's the decision, after the action, that hereafter in this drama of life, God was going to be our director. But before we start thinking that the action of step three is a once and done, let's look at how Wilson reminds us of it later. He refers to the action of step three in the step 12 essay in the 12 and 12. He writes, we had tried to play God and dominate those about us. And then later says, if we depended upon God, we couldn't very well play God to our fellows. Step three is described by its author as the keystone step. And anyone familiar with how an arch is constructed knows that the keystone holds the entire structure up. Without the keystone, the structure literally fails. Or put another way, without the action of step three in place, the rest of the program becomes unstable. The rest of the program fails. We'll go deeper into what quit playing God looks like in another episode and dive into how understanding this step actually decouples God from the recovery process.